So yeah, this is a lot to unpack, so let's start at the beginning. Last I left off, I had had a pretty successful launch. The previous launch went really, really well. Everything kind of functioned correctly. I did a bunch of upgrades, and I had a lot of confidence going into future development plan. So let's rewind a bit and go back to where I left off in my last video. The concept of this rocket is to replicate the flight of a real Falcon 9. So that includes landing systems and making it multi-stage eventually. But you can't do all this at once, so I've done a phase development plan where I add systems as I go. Previously, I've run it with just a parachute and a main engine, but now I'd like to open the floor to more interesting multiple deployments during the flight. Part of that is upper fins that open and stabilize the rocket. Grid fins, as opposed to planar fins, which I'm using here, are not as effective at righting the rocket from a completely unstable position. Stability is real important because if you don't have it, you'll begin flipping end over end. You can kind of think of it as if the rocket was way off course and completely pointing the wrong direction, there isn't much restorative force to push it back on target. And a planar fin, like on a dart, is a lot better at doing this because it presents more surface area to the air and you can make them a lot larger. So that's what I opted for in my design. This would ensure that the engine's pointing the right way, and when we go in to relight and do a landing, it's ready to go and pointing the right direction. The CONOPS, or concept of operations, for this rocket is to go up, reach an apogee, deploy its fins, correctly stabilize itself, and then open its legs to land on them. There's no landing engine, I'm still using a parachute, but it tests multiple deployments at different designated altitudes. After the last flight, I made sure there was no wear and tear on the airframe, all of the parts worked, and I wanted to make a few small upgrades to the deployment and the centering of the TVC gimbal. I also had a new gimbal to try, but I was holding off on that until a couple flights later on. So the new gimbal would have to wait, and I would continue using the same hardware I'd used in the previous flight. Almost nothing had changed between these two flights, so I was really confident everything would work out and I would be able to fly routinely from now on. After that successful flight, I wanted to move towards long burn motors. So these burn significantly longer than a lot of the black powder counterparts. In the previous flight, I used an Estes F-15, which burns for 3 seconds on black powder. But following that, I wanted to step things up and use an Apogee F-10, which gets a little bit less thrust, but has the advantage of burning much longer. Longer burn motors are more suited for thrust vector controlled rockets, and as a result, you can fly farther, higher, and longer, and it gets a more scale, realistic appearance. At launch, the launch controller needs to be switched to the firing position, and if you want to abort or cancel the launch, you can hit an abort button that resets the whole system. But if the switch is left open for the launch control, then it actually triggers the engine due to a fault in how the programming is done. The back of the launch pad is kind of a mess, and I'm working on fixing this with a new dedicated PCB shield that just installs into it and makes everything a lot cleaner. But in the end, because I was trying to fly a drone and film the launch, I handed the controls off to someone else, and I learned the hard way that if you abort during the countdown, while the switch is open, it triggers the engine. So after an impromptu static fire, I was ready to get back to it. I'm trying to implement a new filming strategy in my launches, which is using racing drones. I've had them for a while. I used to fly a lot when I was in college, and it seemed like a really, really cool angle to be able to trace and follow the rocket in flight with something really, really fast like one of these drones. Luckily, nothing was damaged, so it was right back out to the field again. But this first attempt didn't go too well, and I ended up forgetting to power on the computer on the inside by plugging it in during refurbishment. And I had to go right back home after setup and come back another day because I ran out of time. So the second attempt went marginally better. Things left the ground, at least.
Oh yeah.
Is it gonna go up for sure?
I think so.
It's gonna happen. I feel it.
Oh!
Somebody! Oh!
He needs some milk!
This flight went off course immediately. It seemed like the vectoring system wasn't running at all, and overall, I attributed the failure to something that I thought I understood, which I only now, recently, fully understand what happened here. After liftoff, things go immediately wrong and it begins curving and ends up flying past us to our far right. In the end, it went pretty far away from myself and my fellow spectators, but the implication of having problems like this again were a real concern. So I pushed safety perimeter way back in the future, and I went in and retested things and rebuilt the gimbal completely. After this flight, it completely destroyed the old TVC gimbal and I had to replace it. This was a good opportunity to use my new one, and I believed at the time that the strip servo in the gimbal was responsible for the flight issue. I recalibrated things, set it up with the new gimbal, and believed I had solved the problem. There's a lot of hardware that you have to take out to the field, so every one of these launch attempts is a real big time commitment, and it really, really sucks when you get all the way out there and have an issue. So I triple checked everything and made sure that the vectoring system was working and it would arm properly, as it appeared not to have in the previous flight. So we arrived back out at the field, got everything ready to go. It's a lot of setup, staking things into ground, loading the engine, prepping the parachute, and getting the racing drone all ready to go to film. But in the end, similar behavior here, where things seem to get stuck going one direction. Again, immediately after liftoff, things flip end over end over end, and it seems that the rocket is completely out of control. I actually realized after the fact that there was a small section of wire inside the gimbal where it could become locked out to one side. So on takeoff, you see it vectors over and then it stays vectored the entire time. And this is to blame. I was only able to find this out after the fact, but I did get some really nice shots via Jared of the launch. Between flights, I kind of reevaluated my test plan and I came up with this, which is a gimbal that you can mount the rocket into and it simulates its movement while keeping it on the ground. This whole new test rig was built with the explicit idea of being able to operate on the ground. And using rocket motors is one way, but the alternative of using brushless motors and propellers is a lot more attractive. Brushless motors, like those used on the racing quadcopter that I already have, are really, really powerful. They offer compact thrust, and they offer similar thrust to the rocket motors I was already using, so it was a perfect fit. I ended up coming up with a 3D printed mount to put the motor into the rocket motor tube and operate on the gimbal just the same as it would with a normal engine. This allowed me to test code inside the rocket without having to fly it. And it's a huge step forward in being able to tune and validate that the code that I believe will work on the rocket will in fact tune it properly and make it perform the way I intend. The other benefit of the test stand is I can directly control what is going on with the thrust. I can vary the thrust like it would be in the engine. I can even provide it a thrust profile like the actual rocket motor, which is really exciting because it opens the door to providing the vehicle with a simulation environment and a validation environment just like the real flight. It also, on the other end of things, allows me to really stress test the software where I can provide large displacements and large perturbations on the vehicle that it has to react to. And it can run over really long periods of time, much longer than it would run in flight. And that opens the door to making sure that my flight software works long-term if I ever wanna be able to fly multi-stage flights, or I wanna fly extra long burn motors in the future. I also ended up trying the thrust structure upside down. So putting the rocket in the unstable position of being upside down means it's constantly wanting to fall over, and the stabilization system is the only thing keeping it straight up and straight down. I can set it with different set points, and then when I shut down the thrust, it falls over. So on to the fourth attempt. I went in with another Apogee F10. We were going to do a 7-second burn. The rocket was programmed to open its fins at the peak of the flight and its legs 2 meters above the ground. The parachute would ride it most of the way down, and everything seemed to be trending in the right direction. Tuning worked, the setup went very smoothly compared to previous times, and we got out there and got everything ready to go on time. So from the get-go, things lift off the ground and they're a little wobbly. The ignition wires that go into the F10 are a little bit different than those that go into the F15. The manual for the F10 recommends that you tape the ignition wires to the rocket motor. This would normally work if it had a higher thrust to weight ratio and could rip the wires off, but you can see here that it got stuck on the way off the pad. Everything lifted off very cleanly though, and the wires ended up providing a small lateral force on the tail end of the rocket, kind of ringing it like a bell. This is really similar to like when you ring a tuning fork, and that small shock causes the whole thing to go into vibration, and the controller from then has to sort this out. I was really, really pleased with the drone shot I got here, and it was exactly what I was looking for, where the drone was rising with the rocket. The only thing I wished was I could have gotten a little closer, but overall, good tracking. The one problem though, no parachute. At Apogee, it did not deploy its parachute, and then it, for some reason, waited until it hit the ground. At this point, I felt I was really close to having a success, but in the end, I just didn't have all the stars aligned for me. The fins deployed at Apogee as intended, but only two of them did. So while I got this really, really great shot of it coming in, I only had two of the four fins correcting it in its attitude. This doesn't really help as much as the four, but it did show that it could somewhat angle itself in the right direction. It also proved that I would need larger, more reliable deployment on my fins. And then sadly, at impact, it hit the ground and completely destroyed the airframe and a lot of the internal components. Sadly, I didn't get this image, which I was really hoping to be able to build up to this summer, but I can at least dream. It was really, really disheartening to go from such a great launch and really great shots of the thing taking off, getting into the air and returning safely, to just a string of bad luck, failures, and misunderstanding for what actually was happening. This is a big reason why data collection inside these vehicles is so important, because what you learn from one flight can teach you a lot for the next flight. So I've already begun work and finished and flown this new vehicle. And this rocket replaces a lot of the parts from the old rocket with newer, better systems. That'll be its own separate video in the future, and I already have a lot of content for that lined up, ready to go. It solves most of the problems I've had with the original rocket body. I've learned a lot from flying the first S1-C, and now I'm moving to the S1-D, which has flown three times already, but also had similar issues. I have finally figured out the problem that has plagued my rockets since the very beginning, and it all comes down to reference frames, which I'll be covering again in another video. So you'll have to wait to see that to fully understand what happened in each one of these flights. So that is the full rundown of what's been going on with my rocketry program. I know it's been a while, but I have a lot of content coming here, and I have a lot of other launch videos to pull up and throw together into a new video. So I just want to thank everyone for bearing with me and waiting out for another set of videos. I have a large lineup coming in the future. A lot of that's posted on Patreon, where I have like a full breakdown of all the different videos that I intend to come out with over the rest of this year. And while I'm not always as fast with making them, I usually have to go back and re-record things and redo things completely several times because I'm just not happy with where things are at. In fact, this audio is a second run of a first version of the video that I didn't like at all and I had to completely scrap. So thanks for bearing with me, and I hope you enjoyed.